So students, up to now we have seen that the structure of the kidneys. Okay, structure of the kidneys and also the structure of the whole excretory system. The structure of the kidneys made up of more than 1 million of nephrons. So microscopic thin tubular functional units. I already told you that these are the structural and functional units of the kidney. So this is structure of the nephron. So if you observe carefully, the nephron has basically two parts. One is Malthusian body. And Raynaud's tubule. So Malthusian body and Raynaud's tubule. First I will explain about the Malthusian body. Here if you notice that Malthusian body, see the diagram. So the Malthusian body, it consists of a broader end of the broad cup nephron. So it consists of a broader end of broad cup shaped part called Malthusian body. You understand? So Malthusian body is the blind cup shaped broader end of the nephron. Is called Malthusian body. It consists of a fine group of blood vessels called glomerulus. So this is Malthusian body. And a bunch of fine blood capillaries present inside is glomerulus. Okay. So the blind cup shaped broader end of the nephron is Malthusian body. Okay. Malthusian body and a glomerulus. So Malthusian body, the blind cup shaped broader end of the nephron is called Bowman's capsule. What is that? Bowman's capsule. Okay, Malthusian bodies, the blind cup shaped broader end of the nephron is called Bowman's capsule, and Bowman's capsule contains a bunch of fine blood capillaries called glomerulus. Okay, the Bowman's capsule and the glomerulus together is called Malthusian body. The glomerulus and Bowman's capsule together is called Malthusian body. The glomerulus is developed from an afferent arteriole. So pronunciation is very important. An afferent arteriole, and it gives rise to an efferent arteriole. So only that the variation is that is afferent, it is efferent. Glomerulus is developed from an afferent arteriole and it gives rise to an afferent arteriole. Once again, basically the nephron has basically two parts. One is Malthusian body and renal tubule. Malthusian body, the blind cup shaped broader end of the nephron is called Bowman's capsule, and it contains a bunch of the blood capillaries called glomerulus. The glomerulus and Bowman's capsule together is called Malthusian body. The glomerulus is developed from an afferent arteriole and it gives rise to an afferent arteriole. Okay, next. The narrower outlet of the afferent arteriole means it is very thin. Because of the thinness, it exerts pressure in the glomerulus. The narrower outlet of an afferent arteriole, it exerts pressure in the glomerulus. So the glomerulus functions as a filtration unit. What is the filtration unit in the Malthusian body? Glomerulus. So it functions as a filtration unit. Listen carefully. The narrowness of an afferent arteriole exerts pressure in the glomerulus. It functions as a filtration unit. So here the Bowman's capsule, which accommodates with one glomerulus, is lined by a single layer of squamous epithelial cells. So it is lined by a single layer of squamous epithelial cells called podocytes. These are called podocytes. Listen carefully, boys and girls. The Bowman's capsule, which accommodates one glomerulus, is lined by a single layer of squamous epithelial cells called podocytes. There are fine pores present in these podocyte cells, fine pores, holes, which allows the filtration of materials in the glomerulus. That is about the structure of the Malthusian body. You understand? Okay? Once again, I will explain. Malthusian body, it consists the broader end of the nephron. The blind cup shaped broader end of the nephron is Bowman's capsule. And it contains a bunch of capillaries, glomerulus, and this together forms the Malthusian body. Glomerulus is developed from an afferent arteriole and it gives rise to an efferent arteriole. Because of the narrow outlet of the narrowness of the efferent arteriole, narrower outlet of the efferent arteriole, it pressure exerts in the glomerulus, so it functions as a filtration unit. So, the Bowman's capsule, which accommodates with the glomerulus, is lined by a single layer of squamous epithelial cells. Single layer of squamous epithelial cells called podocytes. There are tiny pores present in the podocyte cells, which allows the exchange of materials or filtration of materials. Now, I am going to explain about the renal tubule. So, renal tubule, second part. The renal tube consists of mainly three parts. One is first R proximal convoluted tubule, PCT. Proximal convoluted tubule. And second one is, this is PCT. Second one is loop of Henle, this one, the U-shaped one. Loop of Henle. First one, second one, U-shaped loop of Henle. And third one, second R DCT, distal convoluted. Second convoluted tubule R. Distal convoluted tubule. So, the renal tubule mainly contains three parts. One is first R proximal convoluted tubule, and the second one is loop of Henle, which is in U shape, and third one is second R DCT, distal convoluted tubule. Follow your textbooks, distal convoluted tubule, it is there. Abbreviations are there, DCT, full forms are there. So here, what is the structure of the renal tubule? This is the second part. So the urine here travels from like this. I will explain about it. This is the PCT, this is DCT, distal convoluted tubule. DCT opens into collecting tubule. This is collecting tubule. DCT opens into collecting tubule, and collecting tubule forms pyramids and calyces. Pyramids and calyces. Pyramids and calyces, and enters into the pelvis. Here at the pelvis. So DCT opens into the collecting tube. PCT opens into DCT through the loop of Henle. PCT passes like this, loop of Henle, and it opens into DCT. DCT opens into collecting tubule. Collecting tubule forms pyramids and calyces and opens into the pelvis. Okay. Pyramids and calyces, and it opens into the pelvis. Pelvis leading to ureter, last part of the ureter. So this is the last part, ureter, here. So DCT opens into collecting tubule. Collecting tubule forms pyramids and calyces, and it opens into the pelvis. Pelvis leads into ureter. All the parts of the renal tubule is surrounded by the peritubular network of peritubular capillaries. A network of peritubular capillaries. What are that? Peritubular capillaries. So, in the malfusion body, the whole malfusion body is lined by a single layer of squamous epithelial cells, podocytes. Here, the renal tubule is surrounded by a layer of peritubular capillaries, which develops from an efferent arteriole, So here, all the tubules together forms the renal venule. So all the tubule forms venules. In terms of venules form finally the renal vein, which brings the urine from the kidney to bladder. Okay, once again, all the tubules together forms the venules, which in turn forms together the renal vein. So this is the structure of renal tubule. So very important, PCT is there. Group of Henle is there, which is in U shape, and DCT is there. Second, our distal conducted tubule. DCT opens into the collecting tubules. Collecting tubule forms permits and calyces and opens into the pelvis. Pelvis leads into the ureter. All the parts of the renal tubule is lined by a single layer a capillary sample. Network of capillaries. Peritubular capillaries, a network of peritubular capillaries. All the capillaries together forms renal venule, and finally the aorta converts into the vein, renal vein. So this is the structure of the kidney. Now I am going to explain the mechanism of formation of urine. So, the mechanism of formation of urine involves mainly four stages. How many stages? Four stages. I will explain. The mechanism of urine involves mainly four stages. The first one is glomerulus filtration. So the filtration, glomerular filtration, that is the first one. Second one is tubular reabsorption. Third one, tubular secretion. And fourth one, formation of hypertonic urine. Okay. So these are the four stages: glomerular filtration, tubular reabsorption, tubular secretion, and the formation of hypertonic urine. Okay. So the blood is moved. The blood, which is loaded with the waste materials, moved into the glomerulus through the renal artery. Renal artery brings oxygenated blood along with loaded waste materials. I already told you that. So the blood enters into glomerulus through the renal artery. Okay na? And into the afferent artery. Look at here. Blood moves into glomerulus through the renal artery, and glomerular filtration takes place here. So that is the glomerular filtration. Blood from the renal artery enters into glomerulus through the afferent arteriole. So follow your textbooks, it is very clear to you. Blood from the renal artery flows into glomerulus through the afferent arteriole. Next one. Here, filtration, glomerular filtration takes place. In the second phase, tubular reabsorption. Here, the filtration from the glomerulus is called primary urine. Very important one more question: what is primary urine? The filtration from the glomerulus is called primary urine. It enters into the PCT. Okay, From here it enters into PCT, tubular reabsorption here. The filtration after the glomerulus filtration, the second phase tubular reabsorption, the primary urine. The filtration from the glomerulus is called primary urine, which is equal to blood in chemical composition. It is equal to blood in chemical composition, except the presence of blood cells. Do you understand that? So, primary urine, because of that it is called as the primary urine. So, the filtration of the glomerulus is called primary urine, which is equal to the blood in chemical composition, except the presence of blood cells. And all the nutrients or all the useful substances in the blood is reabsorbed in the PCT region, tubular reabsorption. That means in the PCT region. Next, tubular secretion. Now the urine travels, or the blood moves from the PCT to DCT region through the loop of Henle. So the filtrate material moves from PCT to DCT through the loop of Henle. Here also some of the waste materials are useful substances like the components of potassium, sodium, chloride, hydrogen. This type of materials are reabsorbed from peritubular capillaries into the DCT. Yes, some of the important materials in the filtrate is reabsorbed from peritubular capillaries into the DCT. Here, the DCT, the distal convoluted tubule, maintains the proper concentration of the urine. It is very important for the maintaining of proper concentration of urine. So, it takes place in the DCT region. Okay, all the useful substances in the filtration may be reabsorbed in the DCT, and some amount of the reabsorption also takes place in the PCT region. Next is formation of hypertonic urine. 75% base of water content of the nephric filtrate is reabsorbed in the PCT region. So 75% base of content of 75% of water content of nephric filtrate is reabsorbed in the DCT regions, and 10% of water is reabsorbed when the urine passes through the loop of Henle, and remaining concentration takes place in the collecting tubule in the presence of a hormone called vasopressin. What is that hormone? Vasopressin. Okay. So 75% of nephric filtrate of water is reabsorbed in the DCT regions, collecting tubule regions, and 10% of water reabsorbs when it passes through the loop of Henle, and remaining concentration takes place in the collecting tubule in the presence of a hormone called vasopressin hormone. The hormone vasopressin is released only when there is the proper concentration of urine. The absence of vasopressin hormone, it causes dilute urine, dilute excessive repeated urination, which is called diabetes. Diabetes insipidus, diabetes mellitus, that is sugar disease, diabetic disease. Diabetes mellitus, it is absence of vasopressin hormone causes excessive repeated diluted urination, that is called diabetes insipidus. Okay, so this is about the formation of urine. I am explaining once again, the formation of urine involves mainly four stages: mechanism of urine, glomerulus filtration, tubular reabsorption, tubular secretion, and formation of hypertonic urine. So ikkada the glomerulus filtration, blood enters into glomerulus from the renal artery through the afferent arteriole, and the filtration takes place here. So the filtration, the tubular reabsorption, the filtration from the glomerulus is called primary urine, which is equal to the blood in chemical composition, accept the presence of the nitrogen as waste. And some of the useful substances are reabsorbed in the PCB region. Now the blood passes through the loop of Henle into the DCT. Here also some useful substances like ions, potassium, sodium, chloride, hydrogen and other excessive salts are reabsorbed from peritubular capillaries into the DCT region. The DCT region maintains the proper concentration of urine and then it opens into the collecting tubule. So the formation of hypertonic urine. So the other useful, along with the useful substances, water present in the urine, it has to be reabsorbed into the body. So 75% of nitric filtrate is reabsorbed at the conduited tubule levels and 10% is reabsorbed at the loop of Henle and remaining concentration takes place in the collecting tubule in the presence of a hormone called vasopressin. This hormone releases only when there is the concentrated urine is ready to pass it out. So in the case of the persons who have taken more amount of liquids, juices, okay, now they have the repeated urination. That is, in winter season also we have like that. That is another case. We will discuss it later. So now, the absence of vasopressin hormone causes excessive repeated and diluted urination. That is called diabetes insipidus. Okay, so this is about the structure of the kidneys and also formation of hypertonic urine. Okay, thank you boys and girls.